How will SpaceX add 32 Raptor engines to a Starship Super Heavy Booster? When is the next test, and when can we expect that first orbital Starship flight? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. I didn't have an episode for a whole week. I got vaccinated and we are working on a meetup for my European Y family in June. More on that towards the end of today's episode. I'm also entering the end phase of our move to Florida, so there's a lot to come in the next few months. When it comes to the space industry, we've had an unprecedented amount of activity in 2021 already. SN15 flew a little over 1 month ago and there never was a reflight. 2 days after the big flight, Musk tweeted that they might refly serial number 15 soon. SN15 must have done its job so good though that SpaceX just doesn't need to do another high altitude flight test anymore. On May 27th, SpaceX just decided to roll serial number 15 back to the construction site. The three Raptor engines had been taken out just before the transport. Rumor has it that SpaceX might be preparing serial number 15 for display, which would just be the right thing to do. SpaceX has saved very little of their prototypes, and serial number 15 is a historic milestone, the pinnacle of atmospheric test flights for the Starship program. These phases are part of SpaceX's environmental plans for the South Texas launch site, and they are as follows. Phase 1 was all about the so-called low-altitude hops. In a first step, SpaceX developed the system that makes a Starship fly in the first place. Engines, tanks, thrust pack design, avionics. All these components were tested with two low-altitude hops. Serial number 5 and serial number 6 did well. They took off, hovered, flew sideways, and landed safely again. The Raptor engines demonstrated their throttling capabilities in flight. Amazing to see back in the days. Then came phase 2, how to make a skyscraper fall from the sky. Each phase brings more excitement, and so phase 2 was a wild roller coaster ride. 5 flights, some of them more and some less successful, but all of them worth the time and all of them working towards one goal. To get enough data and to get enough proof of concept for all sorts of vital Starship systems to enter phase 3. SpaceX demonstrated safe liftoff capabilities, engine relights, skydive maneuvers, fin-controlled descent. What SpaceX did in such a short amount of time is pretty amazing. And they went through this phase so fast that they seem to be ready for phase number 3 now, orbital flights. Phase 3 will confront SpaceX with their biggest challenge yet. How to build a booster that dwarfs anything built to date. More than 70 meganewtons of thrust will power the ascent of this beast. It's super heavy, of course. SpaceX's new booster rocket. In principle, a Falcon 9 booster on steroids. Same concept, more power, different landing strategy. In fact, if SpaceX didn't have so much knowledge already collected with Falcon 9 flights, they'd have difficulties now building Super Heavy. The good news is that Super Heavy production is in full swing right now. What you're looking at here is Mary's view of SpaceX unpacking a very special present, a brand new Super Heavy thrust pack. It's the part of the rocket that transfers the thrust built up by the engines into the main frame of the rocket. It has to withstand full thrust conditions from up to 32 engines. Expectations were that Super Heavy would be planned with 28 engines up until now. Welp, Elon Musk just upped the game by adding another engine immediately and on later designs another 3, which brings us to a total of 32 engines. And 32 later down the year definitely sounds like SpaceX is intending to test Super Heavy boosters more than once in the next couple of months. The crazy journey seems to continue. Eric from ErikX Space has made a very nice render illustrating the thrust setup as we should see it down the line towards the end of this year on flight number 2 or 3 of the orbital Starship test phase. The inner 12 engines gimbal together to steer the booster through the atmosphere on the way up and back down again. SpaceX is Raptor engine constrained. 32 engines for the booster and 6 for an orbital Starship. That's a total of 38 engines per flight and test. If you lose both the Starship and the booster, which in the beginning is to be expected, that's a lot of Raptor engines gone in one flight. On May 30s, Musk replied to my friend Tim Dodd that SpaceX is approaching one Raptor engine every 48 hours. That's 76 days worth of engine production for one test flight. That makes it very clear why the initial goal for Raptor production was to be at one every 12 hours by the end of 2019. SpaceX is not there yet. In fact, one every 12 hours would be four times the production speed. The Raptor is a difficult beast to design on its own, and while SpaceX is working on it, they are also tackling numerous other design choices for the booster alone. Lots of design choices still need to be figured out. How will SpaceX design the engine bay to withstand the stress? Will the booster hull withstand a catch attempt? They recently switched the design from methane tank on the bottom and locks on top to the heavier oxidizer being below and closer to the booster's base. Same as on the Starship now. The booster has no legs in the current design. A booster catcher mechanism on the tower itself to catch the booster. Likely not by the fins, but by the hull itself. Lunar Caveman has made a very nice concept drawing I want to point out here. It shows the Super Heavy catch mechanism and how it might be attached to the launch support tower, which right now is under construction at SpaceX's Starship Starbase in South Texas. Recent imagery has shown that there are rails running down on the side of the four main support beams of the tower itself. SpaceX could build a clamp system that runs up and down alongside the tower guided by these rails. Either way, it will be very interesting to see them build this contraption and even more to see it actually attempt a first catch. There's a lot to look forward to in Phase 3. Going onwards to the next crazy rendering project from the community, Alex Svan, known for his incredible Raptor engine renders in the past, has outdone himself again in an attempt to actually simulate plasma flow along a starship while on re-entry. He did this to better predict how a starship heat shield would need to be shaped in order to properly protect a starship on re-entry. What you can see here is the plasma created by the extreme heat of an atmospheric re-entry of such a heavy and large object that a starship is, and how the plasma flows around the starship, engulfing it while it slows down due to atmospheric drag. And we have all the numbers. Posting a short video of a heat tile test in March 2019, Musk stated that the tiles will get up to 1650 degrees Kelvin, which would be 1377 degrees Celsius or 2510 degrees Fahrenheit. And he commented on Alex's latest video as well. Pretty close. No tiles on backside of flaps, some tiles towards leeward side of the ship, trailing plasma spilling off the rear flaps. Imagine the camera views of the plasma spilling off the rear of those flaps. And to get to such a camera view in the quickest way possible, SpaceX will, as always, start testing immediately. What you're looking at here is another one of Mary's videos. She's on site day and night capturing all these important moments for the world to see. BN 2.1 has been rolled out to the launch site in preparation for a first cryogenic proof test. It's just part of a booster, and a lot of components are still missing. It has one main tank and a thrust puck, and under all of it there's a new thrust simulator. One that simulates the thrust of 9 center Raptor engines. It's been built at the construction site and has been added to the top of a modified test stand before rollout. Ova has made a wonderful animation explaining the insides. It consists of 9 hydraulic rams oriented in such a way that each piston can push against a single engine mount spot on the thrust puck of the test tank. The tanks are pressurized and the pistons push the whole assembly up, simulating an engine burn at flight conditions. This way, SpaceX can make sure that the system is up for the task before having to build a full-size booster and lighting up the engines. With a test tank arriving at the launch site, it's time to look out for road closures again, as testing will commence shortly. As of recording this episode, we have road closures set for today, June 8th, and tomorrow, June 9th. It is unknown if SpaceX will test BN 2.1 to failure. SpaceX will collect first data on the thrust puck under flight conditions. Preparations for that first test have already begun. There might already be news about the test on the upcoming Friday episode. And after BN 2.1 has done a successful test, we'll get BN2 and Starship SN20. Let's take a look at the progress. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server, where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock! This is another one of Mauricio's beautiful aerial views of SpaceX Starbase in South Texas. It shows the high bay, currently the largest finished building at the SpaceX site, and as you can see, it's occupied. Inside we can see Starship Serial Number 16 and right next to it Super Heavy BN2. Formerly known as BN3, it's recently been renamed and is by now partly assembled. It's the first fully built booster once it's finished, and the plan, despite the name change, is still to send it to space together with Starship SN20. Depending, of course, on a clean test with BN2.1, BN2 will be rolled to the pad soon after. SpaceX wants to get its Starship's orbital as soon as possible, and internals for BN2 are being built. This, for example, is the methane downcomer. It's the link between the methane tank on top and the engines on the bottom. It connects the common dome in the middle and the manifold on the bottom, supplying fuel to 29 and later 32 Raptor engines. And it's already inside the high bay for installation. The size shows once more what kind of rocket SpaceX is building here. This is just the center fuel line we're looking at, and on its own it's as big as a small rocket. It's unclear as to what SpaceX intends to do with Starship Serial Number 16, as it's built for higher altitude flight tests. It's missing the Raptor engine mounts needed for a Starship to properly go into orbit, and Starship Serial Number 20 will have them. This is its aft dome, so the tank dome holding the thrust pack and all the engine mounts on the bottom of every Starship, and those large round disc-like objects attached are the mounting adapters for those vacuum Raptor engines. Shown here in an official picture by SpaceX, a vacuum Raptor, or short RVAC, is much larger than a sea-level Raptor engine. And what makes it larger is the enormous engine bell needed to have an optimal exhaust gas expansion in space. Since the pressure is much lower and the exhaust expands much faster, the bell needs to be larger to reach an optimal thrust level. Three of those will be attached to the Serial Number 20 aft dome together with three normal-sized sea-level engines. After Serial Number 20 separates from BN2 at the edge of space, these vacuum Raptors will push the Starship the rest of the way into a stable orbit. And they will also decelerate it again and move it into the re-entry corridor. It's essential for an orbital Starship to have these two kinds of engines. The smaller sea-level Raptors get to work again for the flip maneuver and the soft landing in the water after a hopefully successful re-entry. Finally, to launch all of this into space, SpaceX needs an orbital launch facility, which is growing extremely fast as well. Back in RGV's plane, we can take a closer look at the current progress. Two segments stacked on the support tower itself, a massive achievement on its own. Stairs have been removed by now, and the rack and pinion elevator explained in episode 166 is now in full service already, enabling workers to quickly move between the different levels for construction work. More segments are ready and should be stacked soon. Another 4 to 6 weeks and the tower should be almost ready for its first crew rehearsals. Right next to it, we of course have the orbital launch mount itself, which has seen significant progress in recent days as well. As expected, for a while now, SpaceX has attached the shorter pillar extenders on top of the existing structure. Next, SpaceX can commence with the orbital launch table, which has also seen some interesting upgrades. As seen here through Mauricio's bird's eye view, clamps have been installed on the inside of the launch table. They can also be seen laying on the ground, ready for installation right next to the table. There's strong belief within the Starship community right now that these might be hold-down clamps for a Super Heavy booster. This is what it would look like according to Ovis animation. First, the extenders added on top of the existing pillars. Some beams in between to stabilize the structure. Then comes the launch table itself on top. And this is how the hold-down clamps would work in theory. Sliding out of the inner wall of the launch table, they would secure a Super Heavy booster sitting in the middle. This way it can fire downwards and the up to 32 engines' exhaust plumes get in contact with as little of the mount and as short as possible. What do you think? Is this what SpaceX is building here? Do you have a different idea? As always, tell me in the comments. Today's episode is sponsored by one of my all-time favorite products, the Rich Wallet. Being a rich owner, I know how great it is to have made a switch to a modern slim wallet. Now, Rich is giving you access to one of their best deals to share the rich with the people that matter the most. Get ready for one of the best Father's Day presents out there. There's a style for everyone. From carbon fiber to burnt titanium, a Rich wallet is not just a wallet, it's something special. Since Rich sent me my wallet last year, I've been using it on a daily basis. I threw my old wallet away and never returned. To make the most awesome wallet switch of your life and at the same time support What About It, go to rich.com/felix, that's rich.com/felix, and use the code Felix to get 10% off today with free worldwide shipping and returns. Change your pocket situation with Rich, links in the description. Today's episode is a testimony of what a space community can achieve when working together. Pictures and animations provided by Eric X Space, Corey 3D, NASA Spaceflight, Neopork, Alex Svan, RGV Aerial Photography, Spaceport 3D, Nick Henning, SpaceX 3D Creation Eccentric, Sam Krug, and many others. Links to their channels, Twitter accounts, Patreon pages, and more can be found in the description. Take the time and pay back some of the love by following them or by becoming a patron. As promised in the beginning of the episode, we're planning the first ever EUY family meetup for this month. The date is June 19th, the location is Eiffeltor Mechernich, and a link can be found in the description. There is a hotel if you want to stay overnight, as I will, and there are activities for young and old besides meeting the most awesome community in the world. Check out the link in the description, do your COVID tests and plan your trips. We all can't wait to have an awesome evening with you. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Annemiek Buys, Dallas Schwartz, Brand Longster, Craig Muse, Dr. Dennis Chamberlain, John Malikin, and many others. You rock! Thank you so much for all your support and make sure to join us on our supporter exclusive Discord so that I can thank you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to Mike, gone far too soon and loved by the entire community. Rest in peace, Mike. We will never forget you.